So, as you can hear on the line today, from Orchestra Manoeuvres in the Dark, we have Paul Humphries, and the band are playing at the Nokia Theatre in LA on Friday, 7th of October. So, first of all, welcome to the States, Paul, and thanks for giving us the time to talk.
Oh, thank you for talking with me. Yeah, it's been great to get back to the States again after all these years. I mean, we did come back in March for the first time in, it was probably about 18 years. It was the first show we've done in LA, and we played a couple of nights at the Music Box. And the whole tour was so successful that promoters said, oh, you've got to come back, and also play some areas that we hadn't covered on our first tour. So we played places like Florida and up far up the West Coast, Portland and Seattle and stuff. But also we thought, well, if we're coming over, we may as well, because of such demand for the gigs earlier on in the year for in LA and New York, we thought we'd repeat those cities. But yeah, it's great to be back.
I was going to say, a lot of bands from the UK to tour over here, they only tour once every 2 years. You're coming back in the same year. So it must be very gratifying to get that sort of response.
Well, it has been, yeah. I mean, it's been, the response to our tour in March was so great. The reviews we got were great, and we ended up selling out pretty much everywhere we went. So it was kind of justification to come back, really, because the band we started again in 2005, 2006, we started getting together again, and having sort of had a layoff of, over 10 years. But since sort of 2006, we haven't managed to find a promoter who would bring us over to America. So we've been touring around Europe for the last sort of 5 years or so, and playing, some really big size gigs, but every year we said, what about America? So someone took a risk and sort of booked us out in March and was very glad that he did, because, he went so well. But I think we've always been up against these sort of preconceptions since we came back that, OMD are old, they're an 80s band and it's older now, I bet they're just doing it for the money, I bet they're not very good on stage, and so we've had to kind of dispel all of these preconceptions really, because we're not doing it for the money, we don't need the money, we're doing it for the fun of it, and I think that shows in our gigs, because we put on a really great show. So.
Yeah, that was one of the things about the album that you released, The History of Modern. When a lot of bands come back, you never know what you're going to get, but it's going to be, sounding exactly like they did before, in which case it could sound dated, or whether they're going to try and appeal to a new audience, which may sound like not the band that you love. But you seem to have managed to combine two. You've still got the old classic OMD sound from the early albums, but the production and the sound is, very modern.
Good. I'm glad you say that, because that was really the intention. I mean, when Andy and I started writing again for this album, we hadn't written songs together for 15 years, really. And the first thing we did when we sat down was we said to each other, well, what should OMD sound like in 2010, which was on Head Record? And we quite quickly came up with the answer. We decided that the first four albums that we did was the quintessential OMD sound, in a way. And so we decided to use that same sort of sound palette that we used then, but bring it into the now, because Andy and I have both got modern studios. I've got a studio in London, Andy's got one in Liverpool, and we've got very modern studios using all the modern equipment, and we've been making records. Even though OMD stopped, Andy and I have been making modern records, so we knew all the sort of modern techniques to make records, what modern records should sound like. So we sort of applied our sort of palette of sounds from the sort of late 70s, early 80s into modern techniques and modern instruments and modern equipment, and it sounds like we kind of got the balance right, because we've been playing with them. A lot of people have reviewed the album in those terms.
That's great, yeah. So were you surprised by the reaction, or was it something you were expecting, or was it just a gamble, you didn't know whether it would come off or not?
Yeah, I mean, we didn't know. I mean, when we just decided to do OMD in the first place, we thought, well, who's going to be interested, really? But we thought, well, let's just sort of dip our toes in the water, and we booked 9 shows in the UK, and those 9 shows sold out in like 24 hours, and so the 9 shows became 40 shows, and then all of a sudden we're back doing OMD again. and so after a couple of years of that, we thought, well, Andy and I, we spent so much time together on the buses and travelling around, we started to generate all these ideas for songs, and it's like, okay, well, we're back doing R&B again, the next thing we should do is make an album. Really.
Yeah. Great. So what type of audience are you finding now? Are they, you know, the old audience from years ago? Are you getting new people coming along that perhaps have heard bands that have been influenced by you?
Yes, exactly. That's what we're getting, really. I mean, our first tour in the UK was very much our sort of age group and people who got into us in the 80s and stuff. But subsequent tours after that, we've been noticing, and to this tour in particular, we've been noticing that there's been a lot more younger people come to our show, a lot more young people. And we've been trying to analyse what this is. I mean, I think it's a combination of a few things, really. I do think, as you say, there's been a lot of new bands citing R&B as an influence and talking about it in interviews. And I think the sort of younger audience of those bands have gone, oh, who's this R&B that my favourite band is talking about? I better check them out.
Yeah.
And so there has been quite a bit of that. But also, I mean, I think you know, for us, the internet is kind of both a blessing and a curse, really. I mean, it's a fantastic place to discover music.
Yeah.
You know, obviously the curse side of it is that people, you know, a lot of people out there who don't pay for their music, which is, mm-hmm. has a detrimental effect on the music industry, but I won't harp on about that. But the positive side of it is that young people have access to everything, really, that's gone before. And it's not like when I was growing up and when Andy was growing up in the sort of 70s, music was like a tribal thing, and it was all part of, it was all linked to fashion in a way. It was kind of the haircut you had and the clothes you wore and the music you listened to, and that defined you as a person, whereas mm-hmm. music doesn't have that effect on people anymore, of this generation of younger people. Mm-hmm. Music is just a small part of their lives, and they don't latch onto it as fashion movement. It's just music. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I've got a 20-year-old daughter who, you know, you look at her iPod and it's on there with, you know, Led Zeppelin, The Beatles, 50 Cent, Beyonce, you know, and it's just a whole, all these different genres, and it all makes sense to her.
I guess, you know, the sort of age barriers have broken down, whereas one particular type of music would appeal to a certain age group, and now, you know, people have access to everything. In those days that you're talking about, again, those were days when you'd get a group of friends together who were like-minded, and you could spend the whole evening listening to albums all the way through and discussing them, whereas now people just tend to flash through and listen to snippets of songs, I guess. But
that's right. Or they're listening to music when they're travelling around or walking around the town on their iPods and things like that. But it's not... It was everything then. But kids got so much more... So many more things. I mean, when we were growing up in the 70s, there was no internet. There was barely anything to do with music on the television. And there were no DVDs and things like that. There was no YouTube to entertain you. So music was the thing. That was the thing. That was your one sort of entertainment, really, where there was a whole smorgasbord of things that kids loved and entertained themselves with, that music is just a small part of.
Yeah. So this time round, does the whole process feel any different from before compared to the 80s? The process of writing and recording, obviously technology's changed. Do you find that your approach to writing and recording has changed along with that?
I mean, I think with the album, we decided to, because we've got a geographical problem, Andy and I, because, you know, we're the two of the band that write the songs. I live in London and Andy lives in Liverpool. And we're like, so, as you know, it's about 200 miles apart. So it was a bit of a problem. But we thought, well, like, we can solve that. We'll just use the internet. And we got duplicate systems on our computers so that we could load all the files at no problem. So we'd be sending internet files across to each other, and one would work and send it back. But in the end, we decided that it wasn't a very creative way to do it. Because OMD's great record, the best work that Andy and I have done together is when we've been in the same room together, mm-hmm. and someone will, in the morning, throw in a mad idea into the room, and we'll bat it around all day, and at the end, we'll have something that we really like quite often. And it's all about the energy in the room, and by the internet, we couldn't have that at all. So I ended up, because Andy's got small kids who are in school up in Liverpool, I ended up going to Liverpool for a week every 2 weeks, and I'd be working at the studio, and all of a sudden the album came together like really swiftly, sort of, dragging us for months, and all of a sudden we got the album together.
Yeah, that's the thing, when you bounce ideas off each other, you know, you can come up with things that on your own you might not have thought of.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, that's the great thing about a writing partnership when it works, and so you were stupid to think otherwise, really. But anyway, it worked out for the better. But the other thing about making a record now is that we've kind of come full circle. We're kind of back to where we were when we were kids making music, because we have no pressure anymore. Yeah. We don't have anyone to answer to. There's not a record company. Like, throughout the 80s, towards the end of the 80s, we were under immense pressure from record labels and management, and we were part of it. You know, we had this big, all these people employed by us, and there was all this pressure to be making money, and that was affecting our music.
Yeah.
But now, we don't think of these kinds of things. We are the bosses. We have our own record label. We release our records too. Mm-hmm. And Andy and I are back completely in control again, and we just decide what happens, and we can work with Peggy on, we can decide when we call.
Yeah.
And so it's become really great fun again. Yeah. Where it ceased to become fun towards the 80s into the 90s, it stopped becoming fun, and I think that was showing in the music we had.
And those pressures in the 90s, was that contributing factor towards the breakup of the band? The eternal, touring, recording, and especially with the music business?
That was a huge part of it, but also in the 90s, what happens in sort of one decade, you get into a new decade, and the decade usually rejects the decade that's gone before. So all the great electronic music from the 80s was sort of rejected in the 90s, and there was all these new bands, all these guitar bands that came through, and people were rejecting electronic music, and there was like Oasis coming through, and people had gone, electro had gone out of fashion, and it was weird for us because we started in the 70s thinking electronic music was the future. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden we get to the 90s and it's like, well, the future now sounds like the 60s. What's going on here? So we felt we were banging our heads against the wall, so we stopped.
Yeah. So then how did the reunion come about when you got back together again? What brought that into play?
Well, we never really fell out because, we've all known each other from school. I mean, we thought that we had really bad breakup and stuff like that. But it really wasn't. So Andy and I had our differences, and maybe we didn't speak so much for a couple of years, but there was never really good falling out. And I went up to see him in 2000, and so I was just visiting, and I live in London now, so I popped in to see him in the studio, and we had a really nice time together, and had dinner, and discussed getting R&B back together, because we kind of missed working with each other, but he had a few projects he was committed to, and I had a few projects, and he was finishing those, and I had already committed to some projects, so it was like, we got to 2005, and it was like, come on, unless we kind of set a date where we start this R&B thing again, we're never going to get it started, so.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it took sort of 5 years for us to actually make it happen.
Mm-hmm.